special because it's a celebration of the life of someone whose work has been one of the inspirations for the Water School Africa, Zephaniah Phiri. Unfortunately, Ken Wilson, who knew Zephaniah very well, sends his apologies and best wishes. He's not well and so is unable to present. We also have apologies from Abraham Mawere, who also knew him very well, but his son Daniel is here and will present on his behalf. So instead of them presenting, we're going to start off with a short film about Phiri, and then we'll hear testimonies from some of those who knew, worked with him, and put into practice what they learned from him. Then we'll open it up for discussion, and you may have questions, comments, or whatever you feel like, as we normally do. So I think let's get going with the film. Minnie, I don't know if you have anything else to add, otherwise we go straight on to the film.
I just want to say welcome to everybody and thank you for joining us for this session. The Water Harvester is a phenomenal film about Zephaniah in Zephaniah's own words. So as I was saying that unfortunately Zephaniah is not with us today, but in his own words, it's like having a presentation from him. So there's a lot of Zephaniah talking about the challenges that he faced when he started doing the water harvesting work, which are there in this very short. Okay, brilliant. Here we are.
Ndikada kuti mvura iyerere ichinda uku ndinobva ndazviita saizvozvo mvura yangu inonditerera. Very obedient water it is.
Zephaniah Phiri is a household name, especially for anyone interested in water harvesting. Mr. Phiri has had an impact all over Zimbabwe and beyond. He has inspired and continues to lead the way in agricultural innovations as he provides homegrown alternatives in conservation farming to marginalized communities. He is a fine example of farmer innovation.
I am a citizen. Shabane district. I was born in Zimbabwe. I grew up in Zimbabwe. I received my education from the Dia Mission under the principalship of Mr. Garfield Tobe. This was in the 40s. I live in Mapanzure area in Region 4. And it has very little rainfall. When we started a struggle, the regime did not want us to be known as the citizens of this country. So I was tortured. I was arrested during the struggle. I went to Gonekudzingwa. I stayed in Gonekudzingwa for 2 years. As from 1964 to 66, the regime was so serious with my life. They really wanted to kill me. I was put on leg irons, 6 months on leg irons.
The detention did not break Zephaniah, but when he was released, no one wanted to employ him.
I went to the DA and told him I had come. I had finished my restriction. So the DA told me that, no, you are no longer a man who will ever have any job in Rhodesia. Then I went to Banabang, where I was working under the railways. They said, no, we don't want you. You will never have any employment in Rhodesia. Then I started to make myself be close to the soil. But the problem was that the rains were not enough. So I went on to try and make some small wells as to try and have my children have education. That's how I started water harvesting. I had quite some problems because everyone became an enemy, especially the RX department. They were the people who were told to look, supervise me, see what my activities were. So when I started these contour ridges, I was arrested. They wanted the 9 inches or 12 inches depth of a contour. Then I said, no, your contours are draining away water. Instead, Region 4 needs more water, but they couldn't listen to me. Then I told Mr. Shaw, I will never stop deepening my contours. I will deepen them because I have a need for the water. When I did this, they came and arrested me the second time, the third time, but I told them I would never stop. Other farmers indeed could not, even today, cannot stand that because the digging of a contour means commitment. But the farmers around only knew that water would just fall and then they could go to the land and plow. But that water should be planted. Even today, they don't have that mind. Though you talk to them, really they don't understand. But they get surprised when they come to my land. In 1986, Kenny came to ask me to join the research team in Maziwa, as to also carry my understanding of Region 4 and 5 water problem. I went to Maziwa for well thinking, found that Maziwa had quite a lot of problems. People had no water to drink. They could go to me to draw water from the rivers. Kenny and Schoons were people called by God to come and stay in the remote area like Maziwa, where water was just a problem. And Zephaniah was also asked to come and work with the research as to really work together to help the development in Maziwa, and we were very successful in Maziwa. The area is so rocky, so it was very hard for us to work in, but we gave our effort and showed the community our interest was to try and bring the people to better life.
Water harvesting innovations in Region 4 have transformed lives.
They are indeed well improved. Thousands of them in here. Some of them now, I'm even younger than them. What they are doing, it's quite a challenge to me. Yeah. Then I thank God for inspiring these people.
Other farmers have been inspired by Mr. Phiri and they've sought his knowledge in agricultural innovation.
In 2013, when I appeared, takabva nango choice wavo semunhu kadzi ari mudunhu rebhunde tipi mumekesi ndiri Shabhani kwakandaenda saka kukanzi makasununguka here amai kuti mutindirewo kukoswa vapiri saka ndakabva ndati hawongu kabva ndaenda ndobva ndikanodzidziswa chirongwa chekuti kuti munda wako uve neunyoro ungaita sei patsime rananga ndiri ndakabva ndazori extend ndikabva ndaisa madeadly level contest saka madeadly level contest akandibetsera futi unyoro vakati kuti munda wako urambe iri mhandara zvinoda kuti unyatso kufida nemufudzo wewo kuti haurimi uchiramba uchishandukura ifu rako saka ndakabva ndaramba nchirima munda wangu ndakaita tigawo zvigorabhera izvo panzvimbo duku asi iko zvino ndanchidya mabura cherezvo ndiri kudya mabura upenyu hwangu pari zvino hwashanduka mari yechikoro chaiyo chaiyo kana yemabhuku evana vechikoro handichemi murume wangu ari pamba ndakasununguka kuti izvezvi ndichibva pandogona kubudisa kana mukomo 3 yematomatisi nemunda wangu waramba uri unyoro nokuda kwekufidha ukoko tsime rangu raramba kudzikira zvakanyanya nokuda kwekuti water level iri pamusoro naiyowo iri pamusoro saka zvabva zvandisumudzira chero vazhinji vakazoona kuti iva mai vari kutoita zvinhu zvakanaka
Farmers have sought knowledge from Mr. Phiri and have gone on to do greater works on their land. Lucia Dube from Majiwa is one of the successful beneficiaries of water harvesting in Shishavani.
Zvidzidzo zvekuchengeta mvura katinokwanisa kubva taenda saka ndabva kwapiri ndobvandakaona kuti zvakakosherei kuchengetedza mvura nekuti ndakauya ndabva kwapiri ndikatanga kuchera ndaichera kubva na 6 kusvika na 6 dzamanheru kusvika na 5 na 3 dzeusiku kusvika na 6 dzamakuseni ndichidhiga nzvimbo yedu inei yakagosha inokumidza kuuma saka kuhavhesita mvura kuno kwakanakira munzvimbo yedu ino nekuti kana ukahavhesita mvura sezvidhamu izvi chinogona kutora 3 months, 4 months chine mvura taitorewa nashuro chaibva nakamba vaitosikamwa hatachingori vanhu vari pasi ende vanhu vari puwa zvokutoti vanhu vaitongofungidzira zvidzimba zviviri zvamuri kuona ndo zvaiva
Great, thanks for showing that, Minnie. So there you, I think that's a nice way of introducing our session is to actually hear from Vapiri himself. I think you can put the connection, the link for the film, we can share it. And if you want to watch the rest of it, you can. That's really an introduction. So I think now we'll hand over to Daniel of Mwonde. To lead us. So we'll hear directly from some farmers who worked with Mr. Phiri during his life. Daniel, over to you.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Yeah, I'm here to present Zephaniah Phiri's work as reported by Abraham Love. Abraham Love came to know Mr. Phiri in October 1987 when he joined the research team in Mototo ward being conducted by Dr. Ken Wilson. During that period, Mr. Mawere was Ken Wilson's research assistant. Mr. Zephaniah Phiri Maseko was preaching about water harvesting when he joined the research team. He was quoted saying, "The field of Eden was given to Adam and Eva. And the Lord said to Adam and Eva, yes, the land, keep it and use it. Therefore, he wanted Majiwa people to keep the land and use it. Just like what Adam and Eva were instructed by the Lord, Mr. Phiri's teachings inspired Mr. Mawere to a point that he realized that water harvesting was only source of life for the people who thrive on earth. He always told people to stay outside monitoring water when it is raining. It is the good time for water harvesting, structuring, and siting when it is raining. Mr. Phiri also said, in quotes, "I can tell water to go where I want it to go. A very obedient water it is. I am the man who planned water." He also said, "Water is precious, so let us use it wisely." In 1980s and 1990s, Mazua people did not listen to Mr. Phiri's teachings. They came to realize the importance of Mr. Phiri's teachings 20 years after he was already settled at his home area in Mbambanzori. In early 2000, the Mazua people started making structures which were not up to standard, but they were not trying to emulate the teachings of Mr. Phiri. Dr. Ken Wilson and Mr. Mawere thought of reviving and spread the work of Mr. Phiri. According to our research, Shawane people, especially those from Mazua, were always on drought relief because they were not harvesting the little rains they received. Our research of 30 years revealed that Mazua people had developed a government and donor dependent syndrome. In 2012, when then decided to form Mwondi Trust to try and implement water harvesting innovations which were done by Mr. Phiri. In 2012, Mr. Mawere was invited to America by Dr. Ken Wilson, and there they created the Friends of Mwondi Network. The Friends of Mwondi pledged to support and endeavors the projects. In September 2013, the Mwondi Trust came to life. Water harvesting emerged as the heart of Mwondi's work. I knew the degree of certainty that only answer is to consult the old man since he was alive. Mr. Mawere also knew that there were people already experimenting on water harvesting structures. Those were discovered during the three-decade research with Dr. Ken Wilson and Abraham Mawere-Law. Among their respective homes, Mr. Mawere selected 10 young women for a week, for a two-week intensive water harvesting training. Mr. Phiri trained the women to do sand drapes, to wash the water when it is raining, to do selfish things, poor man's thing, forest thing, and the use of gray water, as well as dead level condors and small ponds. They were trained in a way that imaged being trainers of other people in issues of water harvesting and soil management. The women came to Mwondi and said they cannot train people without Bamawere's assistance. Hence, they automatically became Mwondi Trust workers. Having trained the workers made our water harvesting work spread widely. Our field workers were vibrant and innovative. That was also aided by the unwavering support from the Friends of Mwondi. Mr. Mawere also selected another group of 10 women to go for training on his own. He also trained 4 people. So there were 24 in number, 20 being women and 4 being men. It is crucial he let the world know that he was also trained by Mr. Phiri. As Mwondi Trust, we paid several visits to him for orientation. He was happy seeing many people coming to his place to learn water harvesting and other related innovations. After a year, women confirmed to him that they picked over thousands of ridges. The old man was super happy that his life was going to be followed by a lot of people. So Mwondi, as it is following the preaching of Mr. Phiri. It trusts owes its existence to the teachings of Mr. Phiri. Mr. Phiri's teachings of water harvesting are known throughout the country of Zimbabwe and abroad. He showed us a book of his visitors who came to see his place, and there were over 1,000 of visitors. When Mr. Maweri went to America in 2012, he met a man called Brock Jermaine, who was trying to teach him the water harvesting concept. He taught him for 5 minutes and he raised his hand to confirm him that he was teaching him Mr. Phiri's teachings. The man asked him if he was from Zimbabwe and told him that he was from Zimbabwe. He told him that when he was teaching him, he has already seen that it is Mr. Phiri's concept, and they stopped the teachings. He also went to, there was a friend also of Mr. Phiri and Muonde, who was called Brad Lancaster, who wrote the famous book, The Water Harvest. To Abraham Maweri, Mr. Phiri is a founder, a teacher, a doer of water harvesting techniques. In 2014, in collaboration with Dr. Ken Wilson, Mr. Maweri approached the University of Zimbabwe to try and pursue that Mr. Phiri should be honored with a honorary degree because he has done a lot of work that calls for recognition. They also formed the Phiri Award, which consists of 8 members, namely Professor Mandir Kuni of UZ, Professor Zaki of NAST, John Wilson, who is also at this meeting and a partner in Water School Africa, Lillian Machwenyika, Ken Wilson, Abraham Love, and Marcus Akutangwe, who became the chairperson. The purpose of the Phiri Award was to show the world the great works of Mr. Phiri and possibly to lure the government to order one of its universities to grant Mr. Phiri an honorary degree. Mr. Maweri is not sure this day if Mr. Phiri was honored before his demise or posthumously. Thank you.
Great, thanks so much, Daniel. So the testimony of your father and his recognition of Mr. Phiri's work and how much it affected him and led to the formation of the Muonde Trust. So perhaps you could now introduce some of the farmers you're with and they could share a little bit about the testimonies of Phiri, yeah, and the work, yeah, that Phiri did over the years.
Yeah, and we have missed.
Also, what would be very nice is if they can talk about the methods that they actually did on the land, with which they learned from Mr. Phiri, if that's possible.
You're on mute, Daniel.
Yeah, okay. I'm to introduce Mr. Banda, Mr. Clopas Banda. He went to Mr. Phiri on his own sometime back. I'm sure he's going to tell the dates. He went there with the interest to see how Mr. Phiri was doing such a work, so that he will implement it on his homestead, so we can hear more from you.
So, and that was in the 1990s, he went there, around, fairly early on?
Yeah, we hear from him, it's here.
Okay, great. Maybe we can see him or not, you just not trusting the internet. Okay, you'll translate, will you, Daniel, or someone will translate? He's going to Vabanda.
Yeah, I should do that.
No. Okay. Majita. Okay, maybe switch the video off, Daniel. It may be the wavelength problem. We're not hearing you now. It looks like they've
I think their network is very, very poor. Unfortunately, they're in the back of beyond, so it's not
that
very.
That was my mistake to ask them to switch the video on. Yeah, just a quick explanation to others while they're coming back.
They're back. John, they're back.
Okay.
You're on mute, so we can't hear you, Daniel. Could you put on, yeah. And you can switch off the video if that affects your bandwidth.
My name is Clopas Banda. I come from Majiwa, which is in Shevani.
I'm
talking about Mr. Phiri's work.
Soil and water conservation.
On water harvesting and soil conservation.
In Indaka, Anishaba Phiri. Varikumbakwa Undika Indako.
I hear about Mr. Phiri, then I decided to visit his home. The intention was to go and see what Mr. Phiri was doing.
No kudzidza.
And also to learn about all what Mr. Phiri was doing.
Ndakatanga chavakatanga kundidzidzisa kuchengeta mvura nekuchera matsime.
He first taught me about how to harvest water and also to dig small ponds. And also on fish farming. And also the planting of trees. And also how to plant vativa grass for the benefit of livestock. According to him, he has seen Mr. Phiri as a hard worker man.
Taimuka zuwa nezuwa kuseni before 6 tabakumunda kwao.
They get up as early as 6 a.m. to go to Mr. Phiri's field.
Basarabo guru ravakanyanya isa kundidzidzisa nanhasi. Ini ndiri mupenyu nokuda kwebasarabo Phiri.
He was taught Miss Phiri's works. Because of Miss Phiri's work, he is still alive because he's benefiting a lot from there. He said people should not starve because they have to work for them to get
food.
He said, because of all the water harvesting techniques he have been taught from Mr. Phiri, poverty and starvation should be eradicated among people.
Mr.
Phiri was not segregating people, in regardless of the area he came from, that is black, white, or he may come from abroad, America, or in any African nation. He just want to teach everyone the water harvesting concepts.
He said
he is one of Mr. Phiri's students in water harvesting.
Ndapamuonde trust muonde sezveri muonde trust kuratidza mabasa ava Phiri in hand.
Since he is one of Mr. Phiri's student, today he gave muonde trust the fig tree for them to plant it at the muonde center today.
Izvozvo zvinoratidza kuti vana vose vakadzidziswa nava Phiri vakaita saizvozvo.
His passion is eager to see most of the Phiri students implement what Mr. Phiri taught them.
Mvura inoteerera zvawaibudza.
he is saying water listens to what you instruct it to do.
This was attacked at this one of a Phiri issues.
He said it was Mr. Piri's vision.
Vapiri vaya vasingadi kuona goronga.
Mr. Phiri didn't want to see the gully areas, the eroded areas.
Kanambure pamatenga eimba roof water harvesting. Vapiri vaitibudza kuti ngatichisai.
He is also saying Mr. Phiri taught his students how to harvest the roof water.
We pazviri mwazvedu zvataidzidzisiwa navapiri vapiri vaitishandisa ma fertilizers kana ma pesticides.
He was also advised not to use chemicals, fertilizers on their fields. They were advised to use the original manure, that is organic farming.
Saka basa ravapiri rakatekeshera nokuti ivo vapiri ndo vakarishambadzira.
He said Mr. Phiri's work is all over because he's the one who advertised it throughout the world.
Takatanga tisingazvione asi tikazozviona.
He said at first it looks as if it was a very small work, but now we have seen that his work is a very big one, because most people, they are benefiting out of it. By so doing, now they are also capable to send their children to school.
Nemashoko iwawa andataura mpe basa ravapiri ndinotenda.
So it's thank you.
Great. So, thanks very much. That tender chaizo Babanda. Thank you very much. I've been to Mr. Banda's farm and I've seen what he's implemented. And he catches every drop falling from his homestead and has sunk it into various ponds and ditches. And it's very much, Phiri was very much like that. It was about one's attitude to water and really understanding it and then finding your own methods to get it into the ground. Daniel, anyone else to present from there to share a little testimony from amongst farmers?
Yeah, we have got Ndakaziwa Hove, who is also on that video. Maybe you can see. Can see a little bit so that we can continue with the presentation.
Great. Okay, go ahead. And then we'll go into some discussion, questions, comments, and so on.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. Welcome.
Hi.
It's on mute. Okay. Go ahead.
My name is Ndakaziwa from Majiwa. I am a farmer and also a worker of Monde. I am a married woman with five children, one boy. Vapiri Ndakaziwa 2013.
You've gone on mute again. Daniel, somehow it's gone on mute again. Okay, there we go.
Vapiri ndakavaziva semukuru wangu pamakore esure vachiwana mukuru wangu asi ndakanga ndisingazivi kuti vaine basa rakanaka kudai.
I knew Mr. Phiri long back in 2013 and I didn't know that he is such a good worker.
Vapiri pandakazivaona 2013 vakatanga kundigamuchira nemufaro mukuru kwazvo.
When I saw Mr. Phiri in 2013, he welcomed me very well.
Semun akanga aenda kunoita workshop ukoko yekudzidziswa zvekukohwa mvura.
I went there for a workshop of water conservative methods.
Pachangu ini ndaiita zvekuchengetawo mvura asi ndakanga ndisina ruzivo rwakanyanya. Ndaichera mvura yangu
I myself was into water conservative, but I had no knowledge of how to conserve water very well.
Ndaichera mvura ndaiva nedhamu asi raipinda jecha asi ndazoenda kwavapiri ndakazonowana ruzivo rwakanaka.
I had a dam, but the problem the dam was filled with sand, so I went to Mr. Phiri so that he can show me the good way of water conservation.
Ndakaenda kwavapiri ndikanogara 2 weeks kubva musi wa 3rd October 2013.
I went to Mr. Phiri's place for 2 weeks from 3rd October to November.
Takaita zvidzidzopo zvakafanana ne kudzivirira kutogwa kwevhu, masendi trepi, mulching, nokugadzira maporas tengi nekuziva kuti muti inodzvagwa sei.
At Mr. Phiri's home, we learned so many things, which include soil conservative, like how to prevent soil erosion, how to conserve water, like the, and we also learned farming methods like mulching.
Ndadzidza izvozvo. Ndakava mudzimai anoupenyu huri nani asi hausati hwanyanyo kunaka nokuti ndichiri kufungidzira kuti ndidarike kubva ipapo.
After I went there, I became a wife with a better life, but I wish that my life would be transformed more than it is now.
Takadzidzazve kuti hakuna ivhu rinochembera. Ivhu rinogadzirwa nemuridzi waro, sezvo vapiri akanga ari munhu aifarira zvokuverenga Bhaibheri.
We learn that there is no old soil, or we learn how to conserve soil and how to make it new again and again.
Ivhu rinofanirwa kugara riri mhandara.
We learn that the soil must be always virgin.
Sezvo Adam na Eve uri iwo munda nemvura.
And we learn that Adam and Eve are the mother of soil.
Nokudaro pari zvino ndakadzidza zvekuti vapiri vakanga vari munhu asingatemi miti.
Because of that, I learned that Mr. Phiri didn't cut trees.
Ini ndadzidza izvozvo ndakakwanisawo kushosha munda wangu namatombo kilomita 0.2 ndokubva ndaisa woodland imomo kuti handichisina dambudziko nemadzishe ndava kungotemawo huni pandodira.
She has also learned that conserving the trees is of paramount importance. So she went on to fence 1.6 hectares of land with stone walls, as you see on the video. So as for now, he is not in trouble with the chiefs because she is always cutting firewood for free without intervention from the chief.
So ndinotenda chaizvo ndangomirawo chibhora nekubva kwamuri ndigorima ndiri mumunda mangu.
So she is thanking you all and she is done.
Thank you.
Right. Thanks so much for that. That's great to get. So we have a little taste from Phiri and his life and the impact that he's had. So I think we can open it up now. Any questions, any comments, anyone would like to share their own experience as well? So if you use the little emoji to raise your hand, it helps because we've got quite a lot of people on here, or just open your video and raise your hand physically. Walter, great, go ahead, Walter.
Yeah, Thank you, John, and thank you to the Muonde team and the farmers who have shared the story of this wonderful man. I had the privilege and the honor to meet Mr. Phiri at his farm. So I just wanted to also just to sum up the work that Mr. Phiri did. So in brief, Mr. Phiri transformed a semi-arid farm, semi-arid, very dry area into an area with abundant water. So he transformed the water deficit farm to a water surplus farm, where the landscape and the soil were all saturated with water, and that in turn transformed the farm into one of abundance. So there were a lot of things that he was growing, and I think we heard from the testimony that he not only managed to achieve food and nutrition security, but he also managed to strengthen his livelihoods because of the abundance of water on his farm, which used to have a deficit of water. I also want to point out that he did this transformation manually. So I saw amazing a number of ponds that he managed to make on his farm, which were now perennially full of water. And he did all that by hand using the basic farming tools. So I thought I could share that for the benefit of those who did not visit him or to see the great work that is done. I was dumbfounded when I visited and met Mr. Phiri. Thank you very much.
Great, fantastic. Thanks, Walter. And I think that was a similar experience for many, many people who went there. And just to add a little bit to what you've said, Walter, I think, and to give a little bit more historical context, what happened was that some of the practices were introduced by, particularly and pushed by settler governments, such as moldboard plowing and so on, led to a lot of erosion in the fields. And so what you then had was the response. It's typical, you get that kind of response from industrial agricultural approaches now. It's a kind of treating the symptom approach. And what was happening was that you were getting gullies in the fields. And so what the settler government did was that it made it a regulation that all farmers should build what they called contour ditches. But this was a totally wrong name, because they were not contour ditches. They were diversion drains. They were 1 in 200 sloped diversion drains, but they called them contour ditches. And these were compulsory. And that's what Bapiri was saying in the film, was that he talks about dead level contours. That's why the term dead level contours now used here and he would, so people dug these, and they stopped the gullies in the fields, but they took all the water off the fields. Mr. Phiri's approach was not this kind of treating the symptom approach. It was a very holistic approach. It was looking at all the water, catching it in whatever way you could. And he had such a sophisticated system that in a season when there was too much rain, he had a way of draining it further off the fields so the fields were not waterlogged. So he had a system for dry seasons and a system for wet seasons. It was a very holistic, amazing system. And that's what he taught people, I think, was that holistic understanding of water and not this kind of one-dimensional approach which was imposed on people. So that gives you a little bit more background. Anybody else like to chip in? Thanks so much for that, Walter. Anyone else got any questions?
Just one thing I wanted to add from a couple of films that I've seen Mr. Phiri speaking, the two phrases always jumped out at me. First, he always said you have to plant the water where it falls. So wherever you held the water, he called that planting water in the ground. And that's an amazing term if you unpack it and think of it and turn it in your mind, that another word for water harvesting is that you plant it in the ground, just like a plant, you plant the water and it goes into the ground, recharges the underground aquifer, and then abundance follows on the surface. And the second, in one of his films, and I keep looking for that clip, it was such an amazing clip of him very passionately showing and describing all those water harvesting structures that Walter, as Walter said, he's dug by hand. And in one of those films, he says, the first chamber, this is the what I call the immigration chamber. This is where the water first comes in. You have to invite the water into this chamber. And then from there, you will send it wherever it needs to go. And that was a very unique way of describing how you invite the water into your immigration chamber, which is the pit you've dug, and then allow it to transport itself, you know, into the water cycle, into the ground, into your farm, through your ditches, through your gullies, whatever else have you. But that first chamber was really, really important, that invitation for water to come to your land. So those two things really struck me, that that's the kind of universal thing we all talk about when we are doing water harvesting, or we're talking of water harvesting on our different farms and our land. I'll stop here. If anybody else would like to add anything, say something. Thank you.
Great, thanks, Mini. Anyone else like to add, chip in, comment, ask any questions? Maybe something was not clear. Daniel, please, yeah, feel free to respond as well.
Yes, I'm ready.
Matthew has his hand.
Let's talk, what do you go first?
Okay, go ahead. Sorry, I didn't see your hand. Go ahead.
Okay, so hi, everyone. Really great webinar series that you put together, you know, and Mr. Phiri's work has been locally and globally recognized. My name is Matthew Perkis from South Africa. We are representing a consortium of projects and reaching out to our colleagues up north. You know, how to preserve Mr. Phiri's knowledge and scale that out. We've got some very similar challenges in South Africa. And I would just like to talk to you perhaps over email where we could further the conversation.
Great. Okay. Well, you're very welcome. Please put your, I don't know how you got to hear about this, but if you're not on our list, please put in, and that applies to anyone else, please put your email address in the chat. And then we'll make sure that you receive any announcements about these seminars, these webinars, once a month, first Tuesday of every month. Okay, thanks, Matthew. Yeah. Do be in touch with us for sure. Anyone else like to comment?
There's a question here on dead level contours, which Daniel, you've been answering, but would you like to say something about the dead level contours, Daniel?
Let me say something about the dead level contour. A dead level contour is a contour that is designed using a tool called an A-frame. An A-frame is made of the local and available resources, which consists of three sticks, a string, and a stone. When the dead level is pegged, it is therefore to sink slow and spread the water into the field through the force of gravity, hence extending the growing season. That's what I can say about the dead level contour. It has got also several benefits, like during the rain season, you can take grass and put in the contour, then it can stay there for some months, then you have manure. Chirindra also want to say something about the dead level contour.
And it is not only meant for that, it is not just a simple contour. It has got many benefits. you can harvest manure after the rainy season. That is the you harvest manure. You can plant trees, the fruit trees, along the length of the dead level contour. And also, you can even use the water for domestic purposes. That is, you can fetch water within the contour. You can even use it to irrigate the garden, depending with the depth of your contour. So it have got, should I say, a lot of benefits within the contour.
And also to me, it has got one characteristic, which is it adds aesthetic value. It beautifies the environment. Wherever there's soils, it is also a place where people wish to be.
Great, thanks for that. And as I said, strictly speaking, a contour is dead level, or it should be. It was the terms used, just so that people don't misunderstand the previous use of the term, which was wrong. Okay, anyone else like to chip in?
Zachary has his hand.
Zachary? It looks like he's clapping. I don't know if that's, maybe he wants to raise his hand. Zachary, go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Zachary Bakanya. I'm working for REDEP in Tharaka, Kenya. I'm also very happy to meet Rob Sako. Sako, I am happy you are there. I want to talk about Phiri. Phiri used to, there's a magazine called Ground Up, and one time he appeared there, and he used to show a person who is very confident about to use the water. In fact, he was saying, yeah, water does not trouble me. I'm always in charge. When water comes to my farm, I know where it will go, and I direct it where it should go. It is not a, so I think it's good we try to have many more Phiris, like in today's world, where we can train farmers, so that they can be in charge. Because now too many people are oppressed about rain water. It comes, it carries away the soil. But I think Phiri was a different person. He was a kind of somebody who was oozing with confidence. And we need now to mobilize our farmers so that they can be like that. Thank you very much.
Great, thanks, Zachary. And I'm sure lots of that can happen in Tharaka. I was in Tharaka recently, and there's a lot of water runoff in Tharaka.
Yes.
So a lot of possibility to get the water in the ground. Great, and Rob, welcome, Rob. Nice to see you connecting, and we're hoping we can have a presentation from you on Nyahodi's system. So that would be great if you could. Now
yes,
you're
please.
Connected.
Second, third, Rob. We'd be really delighted and honored if you would do a presentation on the water school.
Innocent had a hand up and then he disappeared. Because I didn't quite understand his question in the chat. But he does ask, how has the youth been involved? Innocent, do you want to go ahead? Innocent Hueji.
Thank you so much. I'm Innocent Hueji, Antoine. So I'm the coordinator of Youth Initiative for Land in Africa.
Could you speak a little loudly? We can't hear you.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes, thank you so much. And it's a great pleasure for me to be in this meeting. So I'm Innocent Antoine Hueji. I'm the coordinator of Youth Initiative for Land in Africa, member of Water Network also. So I'm from Benin Republic. And my question is, the villages, when the water table on their land doesn't allow them to get water. So, and they see that on another land, they can get water. how they manage these issues, how do they manage this with what kind of contract of the land they use to use this kind of land to provide or to get water. That is the first part of my question. And second one, how the youth, the young people has been involved to all of this different work. Thank you so much.
Right, I'm not fully getting your first question. I'm just wondering.
Yes, the first question is what kind of land management and land contract they use when they want to have the something, the well, and they want to have some water infrastructure. So that is my question.
Are you Innocent, are you asking about the land contract as in somebody's
Yes, land contract.
The legal contract, or are you talking about how, what permissions are needed? Could you be a little more clear?
Yes, the legal contract that they have on the land and the project, the water project.
I would imagine the legal contracts or the legal requirements would probably be different, or there would be different kinds of laws depending on the country you're in.
Yes, that is what from the testimony that I get from Zimbabwe, I want to know more about what is happened about the legal land contracts, legal land contract and the different water projects in Zimbabwe.
So I don't know, perhaps the Mwande group could say a little bit. The land where Bapili was talking about and where Mwande works is communal land. So the leadership is traditional. So basically the government, the land falls under the government, but it's managed by the traditional leadership. But there are other forms of ownership of land here. But there's nothing to stop anyone harvesting water in the way. In terms of using water from rivers and streams, there are water rights, strictly speaking. There are legal requirements for using that water, and you're meant to get water rights for that. But there isn't anything to stop anyone catching the water in ditches, in small ponds, in dams. There's no legal restriction on that. Twamba, go ahead.
You have to unmute.
Thank you. I'm not sure whether my friend Antoine knows that Phiri did not divert water from a river. He just managed the water that's falling in his farm, maybe coming from nearby lands. It's not water that he fetched or divert from a large river. So maybe if he's the owner of his own land, I don't think he needs rights for it.
Yeah, thank maybe. You. Does that help, Innocent? Does that help? Does that explain a little bit?
Yes, I hope that from the answer of my brother, the last one, and the answer of John, I get more about what I'm expecting. So I will see how I can more contribute in the future. Thank you. Sir.
Great, thanks and welcome. Very nice to have you with us. Please leave your email address if we don't already have it. Daniel, I don't know if you want to say anything about involvement of young people in Majiwa and the water harvesting there.
Yeah. Munde,
especially under the Water School Africa, we are now targeting the young people, where we are, we have the phrase saying catch them young, so that they do not get lost. We are trying to stop the youth from migrating from our area to South Africa and doing illegal activities. You know, we live in a good manifested area, so there's a lot of immoral behavior associated with illegal gold mining. So by involving them, we also target to reduce such problems.
Great, thanks for that, Cosmos Hanyanga. Please go ahead, unmute and go ahead.
Yeah, hello, how are you everyone?
Great, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Cosmas Hanyanga from Zambia, direct from Hanamwanga village. And I'm a youth, 24 years. And I'm also involved in water harvesting. Yeah, I'm happy that Mr. Watanyika is here. He's also listening to me because he's one of my teachers who was teaching me about how to do water harvesting, tree planting, and organic way of gardening and how to do organic agriculture in the fields and other things. I'm very much interested in this meeting, and I think we really appreciate the way they did their water harvesting in his farm, whereby he was doing his water harvest using his manual work. And I think that is also what we are doing. We are using our available tools to make sure that we have water. And water is like, so it's very important for us to much progress. I think I also wanted to ask about how are the youths involved in water harvesting, and how is the response from the youths when Mr. Phiri is communicating with the youths? How are the response from the youths, and how are the youths helping Mr. Phiri to do those water harvesting, especially when he have got some trainings at his farm, or maybe there are some youths who are just come and learn and see how he's doing his water harvesting and other things? Because if I get it clear, he's kind of person who's doing a lot of things, whereby for me, you can learn a lot if you visit his farm and have some experience with him. So yeah, thank you, Mr. Phil, for that.
Great, thanks, Cosmos. And I think Daniel Mwande answered that a little bit. Anyone else, feel free to jump in if you've got examples of young people being involved, but certainly Walter, Nika, and Scope and Rescope are working with a lot of young people at school, in schools around water harvesting.
Yeah, else? I want to respond on how the youth are reacting on this one. Yeah, it's a big issue because the youth are only after activities which have something to do with the money. That is short activities which can activities for a shorter period of time, and then they can get money. But we have to continue teaching them, and also we are enticing them by enticing them using a soccer or netball games. Then at the games,
Yeah, go ahead. It was just someone unmuted. Go ahead. You've muted, Daniel. You've muted.
Sorry, I was saying that this is a big issue with the youth, because most of them, they just see, but they are not implementing on the ground. So the thing is to continue teaching them so that they can get used. And we also, we have strategies like calling them for workshops, organizing sports like soccer, and then preach the word of water harvesting after the matches. And we hope that as time goes on, they will learn something, because Rome was not built in one day's time.
Right, and I also
Children, I want to say something.
And also we have talked to the Ministry of Education. So we donated a lot of trees to the surrounding schools, whereby the pupils will plant the trees. And on those demo plots which will be planted the trees, we are going to put some water harvesting structures where the pupils will see and benefit from those structures. So by so doing, they will grow up knowing the benefit of the water harvesting.
Right, thanks. Julius, I saw your hand up. Go ahead, then Walter. Julius seems to have gone.
Are you
there? Julius, go ahead.
Thanks, John, for the opportunity. I was triggered by the youth involvement in water harvesting and agroecology. That's our strength here at Poret. After a long time working actually in depth and understand the youth, how they actually respond into the agroecology activities. It started with a survey sponsored by SKI, and we understood their concerns. And they actually assembled a few activities for them to actually get involved into water harvesting and other agroecology activities. We ended up having 10 teams actually playing every year, as from 2018 up to now. And this year we have seen that last year we did about 4 PDC courses with the training about 150 youth, actually. And they created 46 projects, water harvesting projects in several villages. It was really an amazing, and it has been our worry, how all the community are doing agroecology without youth. But suddenly, when you put a bit of effort and invite them regularly and involve them honestly, they come and they can actually join. And at the moment, we have got some youth leaders in different villages who are actually planning, working with the permaculture club to create even a much more convincing project cycle that are real to support the farmers in the agroecology and production of food and harvesting water. And the water harvesting systems are well understood by the people and the traditional leaders. And you see local peoples and other nearby district visiting this project to talk about that. It is an output that we would not think of if there were no involvement of this youth. So we are quite grateful. And the schools around us, they are also involved, and we are having some several gardens with them. We are so much actually in the learning process as well. I thank you for this opportunity.
Great. Thanks so much, Julius. Go ahead, Walter.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to add a bit about the working with young people. The slogan for Muonde, which is catch them young, is really critical. So we have a lot of young people are in school today, and we should work with our local schools, support our local schools, so that we can reach these young people. And the younger they are, the more easy it is to get them on board.
because they are more open-minded. So it's very effective to work with young people in schools. And for those countries that have schools and colleges, permaculture programs in them, like Malawi, Kenya, Zambia, Uganda, Zimbabwe, you can get more information about how to work with schools from these scope programs. And for those who don't have scope programs in their countries, they can also get in touch with us at RISCOP so that we can share some experiences of working with young people in schools. So thank you very much for that question on youth.
Great, thanks Walter. And I think I've certainly seen a number of schools with excellent examples of water harvesting within the scope, different scope programs. Sarah from Kenya, please go ahead, unmute and go ahead. You're on mute. Yeah, videos and you need to unmute. Yeah, go ahead, that's it, go ahead.
Hi, everyone. Hi. My name is Sarah. I'm from UDO.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm from UDO, Utoni Development Organization in Kenya. I work as the Water Sanitation and Hygiene Officer in the Water Department. I'm really inspired by the work of Mr. Phiri and what he has done in Zimbabwe. I would also want, for some time, if you can create time for us, we share our story on how we do water harvesting through sand dams and also shallow water wells here in Kenya. Right now, I'm sorry for my background. I'm at the field whereby we are implementing one of our shallow water wells project, which is going to be powered by submersible pumps powered by solar. And it's a story that is transforming communities here from being vulnerable to being sustainable. And we will really wish if we could help you.
Great, thanks, Sarah. But we just to let you know, had you finished?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks so much. But just to let you know that we had a presentation from UDA last year.
It's there on the website.
Okay, it's on the website. So the website's there. Minnie's put the website. So you can go on to that website, those who are interested. A very interesting presentation from UDO about their sand dams. And then we'll be having another presentation in September from another organization that's using sand dam, Dabane Trust. But we might ask you to do another one, Sarah, because I think there wasn't enough time, the one presentation. So I'm sure we'll come back to you perhaps next year and get another presentation. Zachary, go ahead.
Yes, I wanted to tell Tune that I was in touch with the CEO for UDO, that is Mr. Munene, and we know the great work you are doing there. In fact, we are planning, if all goes well, we can also come there and see what you are doing, because we want to learn from you. We want to work together in this area of water holding, particularly those what you are doing about sand dams. So this linkage is noted, and we happy you are there. We also appreciate what you are doing there in Machakos and Makueni. Thank you.
Great, thanks, Zachary. Yeah, you can certainly learn a lot from them. Getting to the end of our time, Minnie, I don't know if you want to say any reflections. Anyone else? Any final reflections before we call it a day? Paul, please go ahead.
Thanks. That was fantastic, and I will be using the term "plant the water" in my next talk. I'm a hydrologist. I'm trying to make sense of what's happening here, and I'm trying to explain it to others. And I'm hearing again and again that there is a surplus of water. When it rains, there's a surplus, which means you've only got 1 or 2 hours to manage that surplus before it leaves your farm. possibly with all your topsoil as well. So I think we need to get that across to people that once it's raining, you can manage it once. And that's what we need to do, and get it into the ground and get that surplus so it recharges the groundwater and keeps the rivers flowing. I'm also fascinated about keeping the trees, because that cools the whole system and makes the soil function better. I think there's a, we need to try and capture this, I think, what you're actually doing, and the key term surplus. Because if you don't have a surplus, then it falls on your land. You might be able to get a crop, but you're probably starving the groundwater and the rivers. So we need to think about the water balance. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Paul.
Great. Well, then, Paul, you must come back with, you can see Rob Sacker's there, and he's said he's going to present, which will be great, because you may remember Cyclone Ida in Zimbabwe in 2019. Well, I think Nyahodi, where they are, it was right in the center, and that was a huge surplus. I think it was like 600-700 millimeters in 24 hours, and their system managed to hold that water. So that's an extreme example, but climate change is bringing these more extreme examples, and that's exactly it. How do you hold that water whenever it falls? And that's what Mr. Phiri realized and recognized so brilliantly, ahead of his time in many ways, and got to catch that water every time it rains, get it into the ground and catch it in some way or another. Minnie, I think you wanted to say something.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to say that this session really is one of the you know, Zephaniah Phiri was one of the main inspirations behind setting up the Water School Africa, and actually we Dhan Bahadur from Nepal has joined us, and I'm just thinking that this method, this language of water, this speaking, this language of water in the landscape, which has come from visionaries like Zephaniah, Rajendra, Paul, Rob, various others. Zachary, you know, Julius, there are so many here, and many whose names I'm not taking, but who are here, that this vision of holding the water on the ground is a common vision, and we need it more and more. And the platform of the Water School Africa is primarily for us to come and share the way we do it on our lands successfully. How can we do more of it? How can we invite, some of the discussion was, how can we invite young people into this discussion and action more and more? You know, that it's also their future. So not only do we do it now, but how they can do it for their future as well. This is what Water School Africa is all about. So I really thank you very, very much to Zephaniah Phiri, first of all, and to his family and his friends and his, you know, all those people who knew him and loved him and for his work, and, you know, sharing it with us in this session and inspiring us to continue doing this work further. If anybody's not put their emails in the chat, please do so, because that'll allow us to let you know and invite you for future discussions of this kind on this platform. Really, I mean, I can't even thank everybody enough for sharing Zephaniah's vision and his work over these decades that's happened. So I urge you to watch that film. And if you Google him, there are many more films. There are many films on the site of Mwande Trust, which you can watch. And they are really, even if they're grainy, there's a huge learning in the way Zephaniah handled the challenges that were thrown out. And those are challenges we are facing increasingly from the landscape, not necessarily even just from the kind of laws that govern, this kind of work, or don't govern this kind of work. So that's my message. Keep going, keep planting the water in the ground, take the inspiration from visionaries who are doing this, maintain the water balance. As Paul said, that we have a very small window of time to hold the water and do something with it. So plant it immediately, as Zephaniah said, and keep coming and sharing your experiences and through the discussion with people who come to this forum, because in the sharing, we have the learning, and in the learning, we'll be able to do it successfully globally. So thank you very much. If anybody else would like to add anything at this point, please go ahead. John, Philip, Paul, anybody else?
No, just a special thanks to Daniel and the team who've driven all the way to Zishavani to find good internet because of the difficulties of getting internet in their area. So thank you very much for doing that. We really appreciate it. And I see Ferdinand's on the call. Ferdinand, we're hopefully your session next month. We'll hear a little bit of how they've been doing some watershed level work, building relationships between people within watershed to in Vihiga in Western Kenya.
Thank you, John. So,
yeah.
Thank you, John. Thank you, John.
Next month. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, John. Are we excited? And we'll be sharing with you next month on the scheduled date. Thank you.
Thanks. So that'll be the first Tuesday. I think it's the 6th of July. So the first Tuesday every month. And look forward to seeing a lot of you again. And yeah, until then, stay well. And
it'll be the 4th of July. Water. Sorry, John, I'm interrupting.
It's the 4th of July.
And our colleague Marie, who's joined us recently on the Water School Africa and who is in the audience here, will be coordinating the next one. So do look out for an here's Marie. Do look out for an email from Water School Africa Implementation Marie Chantal, and look forward to seeing you on the 4th of July. But you will get plenty of notice before that and description of what the session might be covering. So, but thank you also, Daniel and his team, and the farmers who left their farms to come about their inspiration from Zephaniah, Mr. Banda, and I'm sorry I missed the name of the lady farmer who was there after Mr. Banda. So thank you very much.
Thank you.